2015 in the heart of San Diego. This is Screen Junkies Movie Fight. And now your host, Andy Signor.
Wow, welcome! Welcome to our first Comic-Con Movie Fight! Wow! This is gonna be so fun, guys. Can I say, we have some amazing fighters for you guys. I'm so excited. What do you say we just bring them in, yes? First up, you know him. He's the better half of the Schmoes No crew. The Keel One, as Tal likes to call him. It's Mark Ellis! How many towels? All right, welcome, Mark.
Anytime you spill water in the nameplate, means you're probably not hanging out in movie fights for that
long.
Thank
you, sir. Good way to start. Next up, you're all standing up. Next up, you know him, you love him. He's got an amazing YouTube channel, Mr. Jeremy Johns.
Where do I sit, man?
We're bringing you all out first, and then you're gonna hover. All right, well, I'm bringing all of our fighters out so you know what we have, and then we're gonna do our battles. Next up, another master on YouTube. We love him. It's Mr. Chris Stuckman! Thank you. Thank you for coming, guys. I'm so excited. Still, oh, it's not done. We're bringing more. You ready? Ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, Maria. Mr. Spencer Gilbert!
I didn't think he was going to be here. I did not think he was going to be here.
Spencer! Next up. He's the champion. You know him. It's Dan Merle! Wow. All right. We're not done yet. This would be an amazing movie fights, right? No. Let's bring in Alicia Malone! Should we do this? Wait, no. All right, let's bring in Mike Carlson! Hashtag Botanicus! All right, I think we're good. Are you guys ready to fight? This is gonna be fun, right? Oh, wait, are we forgetting somebody? You know him, he got married by The Rock. It's Nick Mundy! All right, wow. Now, all right, how cool is this? So this is gonna be a special episode. We're doing one-on-one rounds. We have 8 rounds here. So it's gonna be elimination. We got 4 round battles. And guess who's gonna help me judge today? All of you guys. All of you guys.
Andy,
yes!
Andy, I just have to say, if a meteor hit the convention center, there'd be no more movie content on the internet.
No, we'd be in trouble. So Hal, I need your help.
Yes.
Hal, we had to predetermine some questions, so you guys are going to help pick the questions, but we have more than we're going to do here. So Hal's going to go around, raise your hand, but please don't go crazy. He's going to find some people to help us with the questions, so go start that, Hal.
Okay.
The rest of you guys, if you'll hang out, we're going to start our first round. Hal, find out who's going to help us with the first question. The first round is going to be Mark Ellis versus Nick Mundy. If the rest of you guys want to hang on the side, wherever, together, that way you all can watch and see how this goes down.
Let's go, Mundy!
So,
Andy, we have our first question, and it's a doozy. Let me know when you're ready.
I'm ready. Let's get it
ready.
Thank you, guys.
What's your name, my dear?
It's a live show.
TQ.
TQ. All right. TQ is going to read the first question going out to Mark Ellis and Nick Mundy.
Okay. What is the best Batman movie and best portrayal by an actor who's portrayed Batman in a movie?
So I'm going to repeat. Yeah. Can you repeat that for us, Hal?
Great. What is the best movie Batman? Best portrayal by an actor who's portrayed Batman in any movie.
So now, guys, I need your help. Before we start this, they're going to be timed. They have 6 minutes. You guys are going to each start with an opening, and then you're going to go head-to-head, okay? Now, we got to listen, guys. This isn't about your favorite Batman. It's about who made the best movie argument. Does everyone understand?
It's not about who loves America more either. We both love America.
It's not
no, we don't. If you loved America, you would wear pants representing America.
All right.
You fool.
So do you guys know who you're going to pick?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me?
We have our first time.
First time.
So in the case of a tie...
I have a coin.
I have a coin.
Who puts change in their wallet?
Nick, do you mind if Nick calls it? Or
I do not.
Call it, Nick.
Heads.
It's heads. Nick will be fighting for Michael Keaton. You have a minute to think who you're going to do instead.
Da, 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 da,
all right, we're going to start the clock. Are you ready?
I'm prepared.
So Nick Mundy's going to take Michael Keaton. You're taking Christian Bale.
Yes, sir.
All right. You guys have 6 minutes on the clock, and then the judges in the audience are going to help me determine who won. Are you guys ready? Yeah. Fight.
Okay. Michael Keaton's not only the best Batman, he's the most interesting Bruce Wayne there has ever been. He's the most realistic Bruce Wayne there's ever been. Because, I'm sorry, if you're a billionaire who gets and have his parents get murdered, you're not going to become a ninja. You're going to be a super weirdo who lives in a castle, collect art, date hot photographers, give Robert Wool grants, and occasionally be Batman when Prince is fighting songs. He was compelling. He was in two great movies, and he's the only actor who was smart enough to not do a shitty third movie.
Would you like to reply?
That's pretty good. Christian Bale is the best Batman because he proves everything that Batman was about. Batman was an awesome karate expert, as he learned in Southeast Asia. Then when he came back, he owned Gotham City. He realized that Batman wasn't just a dude running around trying to bang Vicki Vale. He was a symbol, something that was more than just a man, so other Batman could carry on even after somebody like Christian Bale retired. He was more than a man, he was a legend.
Nick.
Christian Bale did not care about your freedom. All he cared about was getting on your phone like a bad 24 episode and surveilling everyone's secrets. Batman, Bruce Keaton from Michael Keaton, was not only a great ninja and could kick ass, but he was also a playboy. He had other interests. He was a more well-rounded person. He had dreams, he had feelings, and he could also kick the hell out of anyone.
Christian Bale looks like a billionaire playboy. Michael Keaton looks like Beetlejuice. It's no contest.
Oh!
Christian Bale's a mama's boy who couldn't get over certain things, and he just became a bully. Michael Keaton helped people. He tried to help... try to help Gotham. He wasn't a criminal in the eyes of Gotham City. He had feelings. He wanted to make Gotham better. He didn't want to spy on Gotham and just be Big Brother.
Michael Keaton stood by while Jack Nicholson as the Joker murdered the mayor right in front of everybody. The pen is mightier than the sword, and Michael Keaton's just chilling there because he's got mommy daddy issues, putting a rose on a sidewalk instead of fighting crime. When Christian Bale was Batman, he suited up, he came to play every night, and he had a kick-ass Batmobile, the Tumbler. Good night.
Nick,
Michael
what do you say?
Keaton had a bat wing. And then he didn't let a whole stadium get taken hostage and have a nuclear bomb sit there for 8 months, I don't know. And let some, like, Bane guy take over. And then let the mayor get exploded. At least Ed Koch was expendable. Like, this mayor had, like, he was ready to do some stuff. But now Bale let him do it because he had a cane. He had a cane. His knee were hurt. Then he got a magic knee brace and could then again get the shit kicked out of him by Bane.
Christian Bale had the foresight to put a great team around him, too. He had Michael Caine, the best Alfred of all time. And he had Morgan Freeman as Lucius Fox, an expert in building all those wonderful toys. Michael Keaton built that shit himself. Like, half of it didn't even work.
Michael Keaton had Billy D. Williams.
And he didn't use him.
He had Lando Calrissian as Harvey Dent. He had Danny DeVito as a bad guy. He made a formidable opponent out of Danny DeVito. They couldn't make a formidable opponent out of Tom Hardy.
Wow.
Tom Hardy was just a guy who, like, you know, Ra's al Ghul's daughter, like, wouldn't have sex with, so he had, like, friend zone. And watch Batman cuckold him.
Let's talk
Danny
about the
DeVito
villains, Mundy. Who did your guy go up against? He went up against
Jack Nicholson.
A past his prime Jack Nicholson. Danny DeVito. Oh no. The guy from Throw Mama from the Train is a bad guy?
And he was scary as shit.
Michelle
who
Pfeiffer?
Didn't have nightmares about ducks for the most of their formative years?
Who did Christian Bale go up against? He went up against the greatest villain in comic book movie history, Heath Ledger's Joker. It's a better Joker, it's a better Batman, it's a better America with Mark Ellis and Christian Bale.
He couldn't even stop Scarecrow. Scarecrow kept showing up three times.
Last point.
Christian Bale is the best Batman of all time because you believe him as Batman. Michael Keaton is a tremendous actor, but you don't buy him as Bruce Wayne and Batman. It's two different characters that are melding into one, and no one's better than Christian Bale.
All right, that's it. Time.
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 All
you
right.
Started, he ended, we're there. Wow. Hal, I need you to go back to our questionnaire to help. They're going to help too. I hope you were listening.
I don't respect you.
Have a seat. Have a seat. All right, that's tough. Now, this is tough. That's why I say it. A lot of good points. I'm going to need your help, and this is going to be, we need to try and only vote for one, please, all right? We're going to do a sound vote like you know how to do, right?
Oh, yeah, so.
I'm going to help if we need it, but let's see if a show of applause will help decide our winner first, right? And, well, let's get your thoughts actually first since we asked the question.
Yes.
What did you.
Immediate reaction.
Heath Ledger. Christian Bale is the best Batman.
All right. She votes for Mark Ellis, Christian
Bale.
She
said because of which part of the argument?
He nailed it with Heath Ledger.
Okay.
Yep.
Great.
Okay.
Now, that doesn't mean that's the way we got to do here. On my thoughts, I thought you did a really good job. Your note about Alfred was great. Your note about Danny DeVito and Tom Hardy was great. A lot more loss you pointed out, which was interesting. He did kill a lot more people. It's a toss-up for me. I could see both. Hold on. I know. It's a lot of toss there. But I got a call to the audience. You're going to help me do this otherwise. And if it's too hard to tell, I'm going to make the call for you. We can only, please, only yell for one, okay? Don't yell for two. Mark Ellis's yes! Michael Keaton. All right. Now don't vote for two. Nick Mundy's Christian Bale. I'm sorry, Michael.
All right, we're gonna do this one more time. Now, I have to really enforce. They both did a good job. Round of applause for both. Enough. Okay, good. Now we respect, we love both these guys, but we can
only vote for one.
Vote for one. So shall we
one
do
more
it one
time.
More time?
Michael Keaton and Nick Mundy. All right. Christian Bale, Mark Ellis. Wow! The People's Champ eliminated in round one! Mark, you're moving on to the next round. Wow!
Nick Bundy, ladies and gentlemen, Nick Bundy.
Roger Barr is so happy. All right. That's how it rolls. Mark, you're moving on to the next round. Round two.
Hal,
we need to get a question quick. Round two. Yes, round two. You know him. It's Mike Carlson.
You already asked a question.
Are you Michelangelo?
All right, so let's pick.
Going against Mike Carlson is the one and only Jeremy Johns. All right, we got a question ready?
We sure do.
They're and in the middle?
Guess what? It's another doozy.
Let's hear it. What's your name?
I'm Max.
Max, awesome. Which one did you pick?
I picked, what's better, Star Trek or Star Wars?
All right, so the question is Star Trek or Star Wars?
Wow.
You're both going to whisper to me.
What's to call it?
Tails. Is that a dime?
Oh, they went in my badge. Tails?
Yeah.
It is tails.
Yeah! Okay. I mean, it'll be all right.
All right.
Wars.
Fighting for Star Wars is Jeremy Johns. Fighting for Star Trek is Mike Carlson. The time's on the clock, and Mike's going to be able to start, but chime in as soon as you need it. Go.
The prequels. Those were bad movies, and they're way worse than all of the bad movies in the Star Trek universe. Come on, are we crazy here? And let's be honest, folks. The Star Trek movies are for adults. Star Wars is for children.
Especially
look, yeah, I'm controversial, but you know it's all true. Okay? Star Trek is about real-world issues, race, language, learning, getting together and doing something great, and also watching William Shatner try to act his way through all of that stuff. Okay? Star Wars is...
All right, Jeremy, get a word in.
Yeah, the Star Trek movies are for adults when they went back in time and saved the whales. It's true. The prequels are not good. I'm not hiding that. But half of the Star Trek movies, they're not. Everyone knows the odd and even rule in Star Trek. It's like, it's Comic-Con. Everyone knows that. But Star Trek, the old Star Trek, what it was, touched on race, equality. So, but there's the J.J. Abrams Star Trek movies, which touched on action and Chris Pine and fun things like that. Star Trek remains a religious metaphor. The separation, not even separation, the binding of church and state. Star Trek is a legal, Star Wars is a legal religion. Is Star Trek? It's a legal religion. Did you know that?
I didn't.
It nope. Is.
Is it really hard to make something a legal religion? Is that tough? Look, and let's be honest, the whales, that was a movie about environmental issues way before we've been talking about them now. That was started the conversation. If it weren't for that movie, we'd be really screwed. We're only sort of screwed now. We'd be really screwed.
Star Wars had a better villain, Darth Vader. One of the greatest villains of all time. Star Trek had Khan. And he was great. But he wasn't Darth Vader.
Let's be honest about Vader, okay? The prequels did so much damage to this character. He is no longer credible. Do we remember little Anakin Skywalker and then adult, like teen, mopey Anakin Skywalker? Like, oh, the grass, Padme. That's Darth Vader, folks. He's not scary.
No.
All right?
That's Anakin Skywalker. And the good thing about the prequels, I don't know if you guys do this, but I totally do this. I completely discount them. That's not to say you need to discount them. Count it against it, for sure. But the good thing is, they're so separated, you don't have to look at the prequels if you look at Star Wars. Star Trek, every other movie is not good, so it's interwoven into it. you have to count them. You have to count the shit with the good. Star Wars, you don't have to count the shit. You can just count the good. And that guy rolling in the grass...
I'm not following that logic. I'm just trying to clarify. So wait, why am I ignoring the good in one and not the other?
Because it's movie fights. I have to make shit up.
Just clarifying. Mike, thoughts? All right.
But it's... Wait, go.
I was going to say, you interrupted me. I still had a point to make.
Go ahead.
The guy rolling in the grass was Anakin Skywalker. The one I'm talking about is Darth Vader. They are different people.
Who was the guy that goes, no? He had the suit on.
That was the people when George Lucas did that to Darth Vader.
and like, look, the prequels are so offensively bad, they hurt us. The Star Trek movies that are bad are just like fun bad. I mean, like, yeah, like Star Trek V, sure, it's bad, but like, do I want to see them all hanging out at like a national forest and like there's a weird climbing scene and then they're like, why does God need a spaceship? That's fun.
Do you know what the point of that is? Do you know why the Star Wars prequels hurt more than the shitty Star Trek movies? Because the Star Wars movies mean more than the Star Trek movies. If it means more, it hurts more.
I disagree with that. Quite frankly. I mean, because, look, Star Trek Generations is a great movie. What?
Yeah!
What the meaning of the captains? This is some of the funnest, weirdest stuff you're going to get. It doesn't have anything offensive like the prequels do, where I can't right now. I didn't actually know what you said. But the stuff in the prequels, it's like, Watto's a weird Jewish guy who's selling junk to people. Like, that's offensive to me. Shatner, yeah, right. You were a fan or offended? Thank you, Hal.
All right, last points. We're almost out of time. Last point. Go ahead. And we'll...
All right, my point is, it simply comes down to this. The question is, what is better, Star Trek or Star Wars? Both have flaws, both have greatness. But the point is, the shitty Star Wars movies hurt more than the shitty Star Trek movies because in people's DNA, and everyone in here, if you're like 18 or younger, it's in your DNA to love Star Wars, it hurts more because you love it more. You love Star Wars more.
Last point.
I believe that the Star Wars franchise is so damaged. You go to those panels and they're like, guys, we swear it's practical effects. We swear we're not screwing anything up. These guys are so desperate. That is not the case with Star Trek. Star Trek has just been this pillar of the community for years and years, and it's a stalwart. It is something that does not go away, and it is something that will always be there. It's a bedrock.
Time up. Wow. All right. Phil, get in there, please. Get closer. Thank you. All right. I need your help on this one. I have a pretty clear winner in my head, but I'd like to get your quick thoughts.
Okay, Max, quick thoughts.
I definitely think that Star Trek won. Yeah!
Thank you.
All right. I'm going to chime in, and then I'm going to ask for your vote. Hey, you didn't bring up the TV show at all.
This is movie fights.
Everything. You got to mention it, so I'm disappointed, but
Andy,
your thing about forgetting the good and the bad made no sense.
Cool.
But so I'm on the fence, so we need your help. Who made the best argument? Hal, help us out. First up, Star Trek and Mike Carlson. All right. Now, Jeremy Johns and Star Wars. It sounded like Star
booze.
Trek. Do you have a second opinion? We'll do it one more time. It sounded like Star Trek to me. Yeah. It did sound like Star Trek.
All right. Let me emphasize again. Only applaud Hoot and Holler for the one. The one you feel prevailed. They're both great dudes, but only vote for one. All right? Was it Mike Carlson and Star Trek? Was it Jeremy Johns and Star Wars? Star Trek.
I get Star Trek.
Mike Carlson.
Mike Carlson, Star Trek wins. Wow, thank you guys. All right, round three. Can I bring up Chris Stuckman? Going against the Stuckman, it's the Merle Man, Dan Merle! All right, Hal. So, we're going to need a question for these two.
This one.
Ooh. They have no idea what they're fighting. Give it up for these fighters who have just are doing this on a whim. I mean, come on. Fantastic job. All right?
All right. This one is, oh, man, it'll really F your mind. Go ahead and ask it.
What franchise should Michael Bay take over?
Okay. All right. What is the, it was a which, sorry. Which franchise should Michael Bay take over? Dan Merle is going for Terminator. Chris Stuckman is going for none.
None!
I think it's unfair. I think that's unfair. I think you're cheating. I don't think that, I told him, you can do it. I just think it's kind of cheat. But you're allowed. Would you like to change it?
I flew 500, like 1,000 miles to get here. Let me argue my point.
Okay, all right.
But if you want me to do something, I will.
All right.
If you guys think that you want me to come
No, you can do nothing. That's fine.
You can do nothing. I just want to make it clear. It does feel a little bit like you pick a franchise. All right. But we're gonna let him do it. Dan, you ready to start this?
Yes.
Time.
It's your call.
No. You sure? All right. He's changing. He wants to play Chris Stuckman will be doing G.I. Joe. Terminator versus G.I. Joe.
Yep.
Great. Time's on the clock. You can think for a second. Dan, go.
Okay, here's the thing. When people say that Michael Bay can get better, they always say, but he made The Rock. That was 20 years ago. So Michael Bay is not going to get better. When you want to say what franchise should he take over, it's a franchise that is at rock bottom. And I'm telling you, Terminator can't go lower. It can only go higher. And you know what the worst thing about Terminator Genesis was? It was boring. The action was boring. So if we're going to have terrible Terminator movies, give me a director who can give me some good action at least. Because you know what? It doesn't matter what Michael Bay takes over. It's going to be terrible. So make him take over a terrible franchise and at least make it interesting.
Chris.
All right, you sumbitch. Okay, G.I. Joe now has The Rock in it because Retaliation has The Rock. What's Michael Bay's best movie of the past few years? Was it The Pain and Gain with The Rock? I didn't really like it. Best movie in the past few years, though, for him. If Michael Bay has G.I. Joe in his hands, that's like the one franchise that can be big and dumb. G.I. Joe as a cartoon was a lot of fun, but it was never like a big, clever show. It was like they aimed satellites around the Earth and like had a beam go across each satellite perfectly to land on Cobra Command. It's stupid. It's perfect for Michael Bay. G.I. Joe and Michael Bay go hand in hand. The Rock is now in G.I. Joe. I really wish Nick Mundy was my opponent because he would totally have my side on this one. Michael Bay. The thing about Terminator is, the first two Terminator movies, in my opinion, are masterpieces. They're cerebral masterpieces of science fiction. They have great action, but Michael Bay does not understand smart science fiction. That is not something he can do. He has no idea what smart science fiction is. To him, science fiction is Shia LaBeouf masturbating and his parents catch him.
The Terminator movies don't understand smart science fiction either. I'm not arguing on that point. The first two were great. The sequels have been terrible. Dwayne The Rock Johnson is a national treasure. And he's the number one... And he's the number one action star of the day. And I don't want him to waste the prime years of his life anywhere near Michael Bay. Because he's just going to put him in the same crap. Let him make it with Mark Wahlberg and Shia LaBeouf, fine. But I don't want The Rock anywhere near Michael Bay. And I'll tell you this about G.I. Joe. The first one, awful. The second one, not the worst thing I've ever seen. That franchise has potential, especially with The Rock in the lead. I don't want to see it go down in flames. I want to see it go up. So stay away from G.I. Joe. Make the Terminator movies interesting.
The thing is... I agree with you that The Rock is like a national treasure, but in my opinion... The Rock has yet to make a great movie, okay? He's made some good films, okay? Listen,
I'm talking about a great movie here.
Listen, seriously.
Nick.
Get out of here.
Back off, Nick. This isn't your fight.
Nick.
Let the man talk.
Nick, I'm timed here, Nick. No, seriously, I like The Rock a lot. He's a great guy. Probably my favorite movie he's done is like The Rundown. It was really fun and entertaining. But in my opinion, he's never made a great film yet.
What's he going to bring to G.I. Joe?
To G.I. Joe, The Rock is like the franchise.
No.
Michael Bay.
Yes.
Sorry. Michael Bay understands what G.I. Joe is. Big, dumb, fun action with a big team. He understands what G.I. Joe needs, which is explosions and gunplay and fights. It doesn't need anything that Terminator needs, he doesn't understand what Terminator would need. He could probably put on a good action scene, but it would look shaky. The special effects would be all in your face and tumbling around. Arnold would be like a CGI man just like running across other CGI men, and then like it just wouldn't work. I mean, and that's what Terminator Genesis was. Terminator Genesis reminded me of a Michael Bay movie, except it wasn't even,
interesting.
Like, well, no, it was horrible. We both agree we don't like the movie. But
yes.
In my opinion, that's exactly the kind of movie he would make again. Another Terminator Genesis.
Your description of Michael Bay's action scene in Terminator Genesis was 10 times more interesting than anything I saw in Terminator Genesis. And I think it needs that kind.
I don't think it does, personally. I think that his style of directing action is completely wrong for Terminator. He doesn't understand how to actually direct wide, beautiful shots like James Cameron does.
The Rock brings charisma and talent to the G.I. Joe franchise. Michael Bay would bring needless product placement and terrible writing with his terrible writers, and he needs to stay away because that's a franchise that could be on the rise.
So you want a Terminator movie with needless product placement?
It can't be worse than what we got.
No, Terminator, in my opinion, is like what you said about The Rock, a national treasure. G.I. Joe is fun and entertaining, but it doesn't need someone like Michael Bay helming it.
Is that it?
That's it.
All right.
All right, wow. Woo. All right, I need your help. I'm sorry, what was your name again?
I'm Michelle.
Michelle, all right, what did you think? Who here, where are you? This, just not to sway, but give us, you have any thoughts?
I wouldn't want to see either one of them, but I would say Chris Stuckman made the more compelling argument.
Interesting. Okay.
Thank you very much. Oh, come on.
That's loud. I do think your points were good. You made it really clear to make Terminator interesting. I think you're spot on. That was great. He knows how to make that action more exciting than it was. But you did make a good point of a big, dumb action franchise like G.I. Joe. There's not as much weight to it, so there's a good... So, very good. This is why this job's tough. That's why I need you. Hal, will you help me get the vote?
Absolutely. All right. Round of applause for both. Good. All right. Now, only applaud, hoot, and holler for the one you feel prevailed. All right. Was it Dan Merle with Terminator? Was it Chris Stuckman with G.I. Joe?
Clear to me. Chris Stuckman moves on. Wow. This is a barn burner. All right, next up, I'm so excited for this. Alicia Malone. Taking her on is our own Honest Trailers, Spencer Gilbert.
Hello.
Wow, all right.
All right.
Pick a good one.
This
Tarantino.
Pick between these two questions.
Okay. Whoa.
Really?
One,
Tarantino.
Or
not Star Wars.
Whatever
Star Wars.
You want. I
can. All right. Hal, what do we think? We have... give it a round of applause for everybody. Yes! Are we good?
All right. What's your name?
Jarrell.
Jarrell? Son of Jarrell?
Yeah.
Excellent. All right. Jarrell. Please go ahead and read this whole question right here.
Hollywood's best Chris Pine.
Best Chris.
Best Chris.
Chris Hollywood's Pine, best Chris.
Hemsworth, Evans, or Pratt?
So who is the best Chris? And they have to pick from Chris Pine, Chris Hemsworth, Chris Evans, or Chris Pratt.
All right. Thanks,
man. Great. We have a fight. Fighting for Pratt, it's Alicia Malone. And fighting for Captain America, Chris Evans, it's Spencer Gilbert. All right, time is on the clock. I have to cut a little shorter because we're time. Alicia can start. Chime in as soon as you want. Go!
Chris Pratt, everything he does is awesome. Because not only does he star in one major franchise, like other Chris's, but he has several blockbusters under his belt. If you think about just last year, he was in The Lego Movie, and also Guardians of the Galaxy, which... And his Star-Lord was such a great mixture of Han Solo and Indiana Jones. It was that archetypal hero we love, plus he's so damn likable. This year, Jurassic World... Yeah, which has beaten Marvel's Avengers at the box office. Plus, Chris Pratt is the kind of guy that you just want to hang out with. He looks so cool. And I can tell you, I've interviewed him briefly, and I know it's on camera and it's quick, and you don't really get to know the real person, but he's so nice, and he's always been lovely. And Chris Pratt, he's a dedicated father and husband as well. He's
Spencer.
All around.
All right. Irrelevant. Spencer.
Completely irrelevant.
He's a good guy. He's the best.
Chris Pratt, they're all good guys. And, you know, all the Chrises have the same advantages. They're all hunkosaurus rexes. They're all funny. They can all act. But what sets Chris Evans apart is his non-franchise choices, is his non-Marvel, non-big movie choices. Snowpiercer is one of the best movies of the last few years. And he was in a little criminally underrated non-franchise movie called Scott Pilgrim versus the World. What if any dummy can lose a bunch of weight and waltz into a Marvel movie and do a great job and everyone will be fine? Chris Evans waltzed into the hardest Marvel part to play. No one has ever done Captain America well on screen. Chris Evans is the only Captain America. And furthermore, he's the only guy of this whole Marvel crew that's willing to walk away from the role. So he's the only person in the entire Marvel universe that might actually die.
Well, can I remind you that Chris Pratt also had roles in two critically acclaimed movies, Zero Dark Thirty and Moneyball.
Who was he in that? Of those? Jonah Hill's assistant?
He's in it.
Is he a baseball player? A shortstop?
He has shown so much range. He's the not only the funny guy, but he's the hero. I mean, when I saw him in Jurassic World, he stepped out and I thought, that guy is the kind of guy I want to hang with if the raptors or the giant T-Rex comes to get me.
Yeah, because you want to hang out with him because he's Chris Pratt. Actors act like other people, not themselves.
He's a hero. Captain America is one of the least interesting ones of the Avengers.
Whoa!
Winter Soldier. I will say Captain America Winter Soldier is a great film.
Captain America.
Because he upped the action. He wanted to, and Chris Evans himself asked for this, he wanted more interesting action. And he wanted to do more, and finally they started to make him more interesting.
Captain America on paper is a little dull. He's strong, he has a shield, we get it. But Captain America on film with Chris Evans is incredible. He inhabits that character. You want to follow him into battle. I don't care.
You want to follow Chris Pratt into battle?
He's the father I wish I had.
Chris Pratt is the brother I wish I had. And I think just his roles in these huge films have spoken for themselves. Lego Movie and Guardians of the Galaxy and Jurassic World. Just vote for Chris Pratt.
We're out of time. Wow, Hal, I need your help. Wow, congrats, good work. That was a good fight.
Did I lose everyone?
It's the brother versus the father. All right, I need your help. And quickly, we need to do this quickly so we can get through and save some time for the other battles. Real quick, what was your thoughts?
Jor-El.
Yes, I'm going to have to go with my man Spencer. He had a better argument.
No!
All right. Again,
Spencer,
that doesn't help
Chris
us.
Evans. Thank you, sir.
Still, I thought you did a great, multiple franchises stepped in. The lovable guy, I think you, more points. Good point about the serious stuff. I need you guys to help me vote this, though. So quickly, once, please vote only once. Let's do this fast, Hal. Go ahead and ask.
Okay, they both did a great job, but only vote for one of our combatants. Was it Alicia Malone with Chris Pratt? Was it Spencer with Chris Evans?
Wow,
Spencer
gets on, all right! All right, round five, we're bringing back Mark Ellis! And you are taking on Mike Carlson! All right, Hal, we need a question quick. You guys ready for this? You guys are back to take and see if you can make it to the end.
I already beat Mick Mundy, so it's kind of like I'm Sam from Game of Thrones. I killed a White Walker, and I might get laid tonight.
All right, ready, Hal?
Yeah. What's your name?
David.
David? Okay, go ahead and read the question.
Which one of the X-Men would win the Hunger Games?
Which one of the X-Men would win in the Hunger Games? They're all fair game.
Wow.
Who are you picking?
All right, who wants to call it?
The audience is abuzz with their own movie fights right now.
Yeah.
All right. Arguing for Wolverine, it's Mike Carlson. And arguing for Jean Grey, Mark Ellis. All right, we're starting the clock. And Mark, go ahead.
Jean Grey is going to win the Hunger Games because she's the smartest, most psychologically powerful of all the X-Men. The Hunger Games are a physical contest for a couple hours. You wake up in the thing, you get away from everybody who's trying to kill you, then it's a matter of wills. It's a matter of mentally outsmarting your opponent. Sure, there's sexier X-Men with bigger muscles and more neat physical powers to show off and get a lot of hot chicks. But Jean Grey is the only one that can make Wolverine into a little junior high puppy dog and friend zone that little bastard.
Mike.
Well, look, they're not competing against each other in the Hunger Games. This is a separate contest. Obviously, we all know that. Now,
that's
Wolverine.
True.
Yes, thank you, Andy. Now, Wolverine, he has literally fought in like every war. The Civil War, World War II, probably Desert Storm, I'm guessing. Okay, so he has a lot of war experience. Marvel Civil War, Secret Wars, Infinity War. X-Men War. That's one I just made up off the top of my head. But he's a guy who has so many cool things. He's immune. He heals. He's got crazy bone claws. He's got, like, a really cool cigar that he smokes. Okay? In the 70s, he was always smoking a cigar, and now PC Marvel doesn't want him smoking no more. Wolverine's the best.
Mark,
that's the kind of argument you expect from the one Ninja Turtle trying to bang April O'Neil. Listen.
Irrelevant,
but
Wolverine
obviously...
Wolverine does smoke a cigar, and the Hunger Games take place in a forest-like atmosphere. He's going to burn down. He's going to cause a forest fire in the Hunger Games. He's not going to win the Hunger Games. Jean Grey has multiple physical abilities that will outsmart anybody that is her opponent. She can fly. She can mess with your mind. She can mess with your mind. And by the way, when you're in the Hunger Games, you're already in a depleted level of thinking. You're hungry. You're tired. You're thirsty. You want a beer. You can't. You don't have all your mental faculties. Jean Grey can prey on that. She's smarter. Wolverine has some cool claws and might survive for a little bit longer than a few other people, but Jean Grey is going to actually win the Hunger Games.
Mike.
First of all the Ninja Turtles have tried to bang April O'Neil. That's obviously true. And here's the thing. I read comics, folks. Do you know who killed Jean Grey at the end of Grant Morrison's run? It's Wolverine. Okay.
He also killed her at the end of the worst X-Men movie, The Days of Future Past, wiped off the face of the planet.
They were stealing from that amazing run of X-Men that Grant Morrison did, okay? And here's the look, Old Man Logan, Wolverine kills all of the X-Men. Every single one of them. Sorry to spoil that, and if anybody... It's like a really intense thing, and it's scary. I'm just saying, he can kill so many more people than Jean, okay? Jean actually has a heart, and she is, like, very sensitive to people. Wolverine was bred to be a killer in a weird Canadian lab. Okay?
Last thoughts.
Jean Grey in the year that women are dominating the box office with movies like Mad Max. No more do men own the competitive domain of physical besting of their opponents. This is Jean Grey's year. She's going to outsmart her opponents. The Hunger Games, dumb people think it's about being the physically tougher person. It's not. It's about mentally outwitting your opponents. That's why Jean Grey, the most powerful psychic on planet Earth, is going to win the Hunger
Games. Last reply.
Folks, I also support women. And... Jean Grey has died so many times in the comics. She's died, she's come back, but she's dead currently. She has not been alive for years. Her younger version is alive and some weird, sorry to spoil that for the Bendis, that's a Bendis run thing. But she's alive now and I think she's gonna make it past the Secret Wars thing. Anyway, Wolverine.
Wow.
That was good.
Good fight, good fight. And you both pointed out that they have both killed each other, so that's very helpful. Howie, we gotta move quick.
Real quick, I'm the fact checker here, and according to the last Ninja Turtles movie, Will Arnett wants to bang April.
That is true.
Okay.
Thoughts really quick, what did you think?
Both were great, but I'm gonna go with Wolverine on that.
All right,
going with Wolverine.
I think, yeah, as a judging to help, I don't want to disturb, but I think, I think you both made very strong points, but I'm sort of leaning because you did make a point, the comic over The Last Stand. That's a pretty good more evidence, but you made some amazing things because of her psychic powers. It's a pretty good, so who would win? Hal, let's get the vote.
All right, remember, only vote for one. Was it Mark Ellis with Jean Grey? Or was it Mike Carlson with Wolverine?
Wolverine goes on! All right! Round six! Let's bring back Chris Stuckman! And he's taking on Spencer Gilbert! All right, Hal, we need a question quick. You guys ready for this? You're back. Winner of this will go on to take Mike Carlson in the finals. We got a question ready.
Which one?
This one.
Okay. All right, what's your name?
Lainey.
Hey, Lainey.
Hey. Hello.
Which question did you pick?
Who wins in a fight, Hulk versus Darth Vader?
Oh, Hulk versus Vader.
Who wants to call it?
Heads.
You get it.
Okay. Fighting for Darth Vader is Chris Stuckman. Fighting for the Hulk is Spencer. All right. We're going to start this. Chris, go ahead and lead us.
All right. Darth Vader has the Force. Okay? If the Hulk is running at him, all he has to frickin' do is go like this. And he will not run anymore. Darth Vader also has a frickin' lightsaber. Okay? Hulk can't regenerate his limbs. He's not Frieza. He's not Majin Buu. If Darth Vader cuts off his arm, it's gone. It's not coming back. Darth Vader has everything against Hulk. Hulk is a big, strong, physical, buff person, and he's amazing and he's awesome. But Darth Vader, similar to what you were just talking about over there with Jean Grey, is someone who uses his mind and his ability to control the Force. He could easily manipulate the Hulk because the Force.
Spencer.
Everything you just said that he's going to do to the Hulk is only going to make him angry. And you do not want to make the Hulk angry. This, eventually he's gonna get tired of holding his arm up and he'll be like, okay, all right. The Hulk can do clap his hands once and Darth Vader's little breathing tube just pops open and he is done. That man is an eggshell underneath that armor. The Hulk can spit in his direction and it's gonna go right through his face. The Hulk isn't just like a big guy. He's the strongest thing maybe in the Marvel Universe. You can't kill him. I mean, you can, but
yeah,
Darth Vader
can.
You can kill the Hulk. You can, but Darth Vader can't.
I mean, yes, he can.
A lightsaber is only going to, it's like a butter knife against a really stiff Olive Garden loaf. It's
now,
like gonna do nothing. It's just going to make him angry.
Oh, that's stiff.
If we're talking about the movies, okay, I'm talking about in expanded universe Darth Vader. This guy can
Talking movies. It's movie fights.
Well, that's not what the question said. Who's in a fight, Darth Vader or Hulk? Not movie Darth Vader. Okay, now listen. Darth Vader can use the Force to fuck. Can I say fuck?
Try not to. There's kids here.
Darth Vader can use the Force to frickin' pull down an entire Star Destroyer to a planet.
Slowly.
And it happened, okay? The Hulk is just a body. Yes, it would make him angrier, but I'm sorry. There is not a single thing the Hulk can do to stop the Force. It's impossible. Yes, he's amazing and big and strong, and he'd run fast, and he'd get really angry and everything.
But we all know that you get tired using the Force. Do you remember the strain of those prequel battles? Like, eventually he's going to drop his guard.
I got to stand up for Darth Vader. Darth Vader's the greatest villain in the galaxy, okay? The Hulk is a really cool superhero, okay?
But Darth Vader wins in a fight?
I'm telling you, I'm about to answer you. All he has to do, okay, there's the Hulk right there. Okay, this is a lightsaber. Levitate. Boom. Dead.
Spencer, right. Thoughts on that?
You're Darth Vader, right? You're Darth Vader?
Yes.
Boom! You're dead.
You crushed me. You crushed my chest plate for a second. I'll use the force and choke you to death.
Oh, you! I crushed your chest plate. You saw what happened to that. He's like, okay, Luke,
let's talk about the
I'm
Hulk
sorry.
Move.
I should have been a better dad.
Okay, okay. You're very funny.
I mean, he makes a good point.
You're funny. You're funny, but that's not what we're talking about. This isn't comedy fights. We're talking about facts, okay? You're a very funny person.
It's a fact.
We're talking
Did
about
he not...
facts. All right?
All right.
Let me say this really
Last
quick.
Last thought, yes.
Sonic clap is what you're talking about.
Oh, yeah.
He put out a fire with that in The Incredible Hulk. That's all he frickin' did. He put out a fire because Liv Tyler was in the way. His sonic clap fixed the fire. It's not going to kill Darth Vader.
You know
Vader.
What else Hulk did in the movies? He beat up a god with his hand.
He caught him
all
off
right.
guard, and that guard does not have the force.
Wow. I got to say, that was unexpected. I had a clear winner when it started, but I thought... An underdog might have pulled something off there. What did you think?
Lainey.
I think Spencer made a great argument, but I gotta go with Chris. The force, man, the force.
All right, fair vote. I gotta say, you make a point. You call him out for comedy, but he's right. The chest plate comes off, and he's a wimp. So just for the sake of the argument, that
the
was a really good one, Spencer, I gotta
plate.
Say, and I gotta call it out as a judge. You dwell on the force, but you did bring up some more examples. But it's not up to me, it's up to you.
All right. Remember, only applaud hoot and holler for one. Was it Darth Vader, Chris Stuckman? Was it the Hulk, Spencer Gilbert?
Did not see that coming. All right. That means we're moving into our finals. Spencer, stay up here. Spencer, you're going up against Mike Carlson, and this is it.
Oh, yeah.
This is it. Guys, can you please give another round of applause for everybody?
Let's hear it.
These people, I just want to say and thank all of these people. Took their week at Comic-Con, and a lot of them like didn't What's go out and party because they're like, I gotta prep for movie fights. So guys, thank you for taking this seriously. I know the crowd loved it. I loved it. You guys are awesome. Wow, this is it. So I have the question already, Hal.
Oh.
Sorry, this one was predetermined.
Oh, can I get it and have her read it?
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry.
I'm not doing a bit, I'm thirsty.
It's the last one. All right, we did. Everyone knew what the final battle would be, and we'll have her, this nice lady.
All right, quick round of applause for her Tomorrowland cosplay.
Yes. What was your name?
Tell us your name.
Isabella.
Isabella.
Okay. Isabella, go ahead and read the last question right here.
Who wins in a fight? DCU's Justice League versus MCU's The Avengers.
So everybody knew this and has prepped it. Who are you picking? Wow, all right. No coin toss. All right, this is gonna be a battle. Fighting for the Justice League, it's Mike Carlson. Mm-hmm. And fighting for the Avengers is Spencer Gilbert. Now again, we're focusing on the movie versions, yes? That's what we all talked about?
Yes.
Got it, we don't know as much about Justice League. We're gonna have to imply a little bit, but everyone understands the rules. All right. This is going to be a bloody one, I can tell. Go!
All right, folks. Justice League obviously wins because they have a really secret, well, not secret, a weapon. I'm talking about Henry Cavill's Superman, who I've said is a cold-blooded killer. All right? He does not care. He will not rescue one single civilian. He does not have any love for humanity, okay? Now, the Avengers... They have a big weakness. The Avengers' weakness is that they love making jokes. They're always quipping when they should be fighting, okay? Now we know that the DC movies do not have jokes. So, Robert Downey Jr., what, you're gonna throw some of your snark at me? Bam, you're dead, I'm a murderer.
Spencer!
Okay. That's all true, but irrelevant.
Irrelevant? What?
Superman, I knew you would throw Superman at me, but this is Comic-Con. We all know Superman's only weakness is not just kryptonite and... magic! Thank you! It's also magic. We have two magic users on the Avengers. We've got Thor, and we've got the, what's her name? Scarlet Witch.
Oh, man.
That at least neutralizes Superman. So now we have to go blow by blow through the other two. I think that Hulk takes on Wonder Woman. I think that the Vision turns off Cyborg. Like, if he could take out Ultron, he can turn off Cyborg, like, by blinking. I'll give you Black Widow and Hawkeye. They can go jump off a bridge. We're still winning.
Thank you for the help.
Without Superman, you guys fall apart. And the reason the Avengers win is because we've seen them work together. They actually do what Captain America says. All we know about the Justice League is that they're like, I want to watch you bleed. Like, that's the level of teamwork that they have at this point. The Avengers are a tightly wound unit. The Justice League's a mess.
Mike.
Well, here's the thing. Like, you say, like, I'm going to see you bleed or whatever. Who said it? We have Batman. Okay? Batman literally can beat anyone at any time in any situation, okay? Even if he's so powerful, even if he's Ben Affleck, he can do it. That's not a hindrance. I'm saying any other character that might be a weakness, not Batman. All right? And the Justice League, they are so dangerous because they live in a bleak universe with nothing to be hopeful for.
They have nothing to fight for. The Avengers have hope to fight for. They actually have a reason. The Justice League is just sitting there fighting each other while the Avengers are two movies deep of kicking ass.
Let me use something from your universe. A man without hope is a man without fear.
What?
Daredevil, folks, on Netflix.
Let me use something from your universe. I'm pretty sure Tyrese is in your squad.
That's not confirmed yet. That's not confirmed. Only things that are confirmed should be used here, okay? And the Avengers, come on. There are so... Everyone on the Justice League has a scowly face, all right? These are mean people. They are evil people who are so... These are people you don't want to run into a bar fight. I would hang out with the Avengers. I'm not that scared of them. They were having that cool party in the movie. I want to be there. I don't want to be at the weird Justice League party.
You do have the bad side. You've got the villains. And spoiler alert, the good guys always win.
I mean, the good guys always usually win anywhere. Except for, I don't know, there's probably a movie that I can't think of.
All right, gather your closing. Yes, you, let's...
I'm closing. Ladies and gentlemen, the Justice League would literally, like a pack of hyenas, maul the Avengers to death. I am pretty sure in these next few movies, they will eat their opponents alive. You will see a bloody-mouthed Aquaman and Batman, and then Zack Snyder will defend that somehow and say it's realistic.
Spencer.
They're terrifying. They're just as likely to eat each other. The Avengers, just based on their fighting style, based on the fact that they work together as a team, you guys have just a bunch of Hot Topic employees scowling at each other.
Oh, wow. All right, you got your closing in there. Wow. Not what I expected at all. Fantastic points.
Quick fact check, there was one joke in Man of Steel when the army woman at the end said Superman was hot. And let's go to our young lady who read the question. Who did you think prevailed?
I love Avengers, but Justice League won.
Thank you.
Wow.
All right, wrapping it up. I think, again, from a comedy perspective, you brought it. I didn't see that coming, that the cold-blooded killers, I mean... That was an interesting take. Not one I expected. But I do think I was very impressed by your blow-by-blow, which I don't think he did. So from an argument perspective, I thought you did give me a little bit more specifics on which heroes would shake out which heroes. So It's up to you guys to help me determine this. This is for all the marbles. How?
All right. Remember, only vote for one of these excellent combatants. Was it Mike Carlson with the Justice League? Spencer Gilbert with the Avengers.
I think it's clear. That sounded pretty obvious to me, yes?
Take
Spencer!
It.
Wow! You did it! Wow, on the shirt, you predetermined it. Wow. Mike, how about an applause for Mike?
Thank you.
That was amazing. Can we bring all you guys back up here? Wow. Talk about the Avengers. They're all right here. Guys, thank you so much. Another round of applause.
Everybody, welcome back, John Bailey. And we'd love for you to help us wrap up our Comic-Con coverage here. So on the count of three, I'm going to ask for everyone to scream bye-bye, okay? One, two, three, bye-bye! Woo!
Thank you guys so much!
Thank you, Comic-Con!
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic, listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.